Hi, welcome to Rise with Chuck. Earl Madman Muntz is responsible for the Muntz Road Jet. He's also given credit for the expression TV. After World War II, he was a manufacturer of television sets, and he used World War II surplus airplanes as skywriters to write the word Muntz Television in the sky. Now, the word television is pretty long, and by the time the airplanes were finished writing it, very often the winds would obliterate the word, and so he shortened it to TV. And the rest, as they say, is history. Now, I never had an opportunity to talk to Earl Muntz, but I did have the opportunity to talk to his son, Jim. So, Jim, your father's Earl Madman Muntz.
Earl Madman Muntz.
And you're a stuntman?
Well, I had done some stunt work, yes. I was in California, and I was doing that in the later portions of my life as a part-time play thing. I had some friends out there. Of course, Dad had been around a lot of the people in California and Hollywood and so on like that. So I had.
What kind of things have you done?
Oh, I was doing car chases and wrecks and anything to deal with cars. I always dealt with cars. I'd done a rollover or two in a couple of movies. And yeah, I enjoy that kind of stuff. Not now. I think it's a little silly right now for me to start doing that at my age. But if somebody offered me a good part and a good money, I'd go out and do it again.
If we're watching an old chase movie, where might we see some of your work?
Well, I'd hate to tell you the last movie that I got a royalty check from. It's called Bring Me the Head of Dobie Gillis.
I remember that.
Well, I don't know if anybody really wanted to watch it. I don't think I could sit through it twice, even if it hit cable.
It better be on the rental stands, because everybody's going to be looking for it now. Say it again.
Yeah. Bring Me the Head of Dobie Gillis. And they brought the whole cast and crew back, and we had a rollover with a van in it, and it had to hop over the thing, and we spin it around and turned it over. And it was a fairly low-budget movie, and I don't think it'll be on the top 10 list by any means, even after this show.
Well, I'm taking a look at it. I noticed we're talking about colors of Muntz cars. What are the limits to the colors on a Muntz?
Well, actually, when these colors came out in the 50s, they really got noticed. And you can look around at some of the colorful area in here. I mean, the array of them looks like anything in the springtime with all the different flowers. And when this was always a head-turner when they got the colors out. And I think originally we had a couple of reds, and then all of a sudden there was no limit to what they wanted to mix up in the paint shop, because they got good recognition when they came out. And Dad was always that way. He was very flamboyant.
It's my understanding there were no dealerships at the time, and you bought your car right from the factory.
Yeah, there was never a dealership because they were very limited in the amount. In fact, the way it kind of goes, everyone was built back in those days in the 50s was about $5,000. And Dad always said, well, we lost $500 today on every car we produced. And that's the way it was. They were trying to get the thing down to a point to where they could make some money with it. But of course, it was being sponsored basically by the television factory. And at that time, the television factory was number three. It was RCA, Zenith, and Muntz Television. And the koi there was the one knob tuning. And of course, that's where I want to give them away, but Mrs. Muntz won't let me. She's crazy slogan started coming into play. And the old play where he used to say, I buy them, retail them, sell them wholesale, was the car business days. Back in the 40s, which he claimed he and Kelly were the largest largest car dealers in the world back in the California days. And then he was the Kaiser Frazier distributor for both East and West Coast.
Something came to my mind, too. We were talking about Tucker earlier, and Tucker had a lot of trouble with the big automakers, apparently, according to the movie I saw. How did your dad deal with these kinds of things?
Dad was very much involved with Ford. Benson, he knew the Ford boys pretty well, and he dealt in some of the early stages. You'll see a couple of these cars here with Cadillac Motors, and Cadillac or GM at that time would not give him really any cooperation. In fact, in 53, their transmission factory burned down, and he just completely left them alone. So he really tied together with Ford, and Ford actually ended up with a couple of these cars for a while, and basically it was the predecessor of the Thunderbird. And the interesting thing about the car, which Dad did as more of a joke, haha, was the fact that this was the first car, and I'm going to say this, and somebody can try to challenge me on this. This is the first automobile that ever had seat belts in it. And why? Because Dad said it was a Muntz Jet and it was fast as a plane and you needed seat belts to hold you into it. And it was really a gimmick. And here it is all these years, now they're mandatory. So that's another first for what Dad did.
I think your father was 10 years ahead of himself all throughout.
I think you're absolutely right.
Thanks for talking to us, Jim.
Thanks very much. Pleasure.
Pleasure's mine.